Hey everyone, this is Ross. In today's video, we're here for part two of our tour of our backyard orchard and our gardens. I want to show you guys what's going on back here, give you guys some perspective, my expectations. If you missed part one, go back and check it out because we talked a lot about our in-ground fig trees, our apocalypse garden plants. We talked about our pomegranates on the patio, our Salavatsky pomegranate, how these things got through the wintertime, and also what our plans are for the orientation of what's going on the patio, and just a lot of what's going on back here. It was a big one, an important video, I think. In this episode, in this tour, I want to talk to you guys a lot about the stone fruits, the potential for frost. A lot of things are flowering, a lot of things are leafing out, guys. We're at March 27th. What that means is that we still have over a month of potential frost here in this location. I know a lot of you guys have been worrying about this. I'm actually just looking at a wasp right there, because one of the things that I was genuinely worried about with the apricots, the plums specifically, they flower very early. And they flowered in like the beginning of March, it seemed like. They were starting to open up their buds. So I was worried of whether or not they were gonna get pollinated, and the bees are everywhere, guys. I've even seen some honeybees. I'm gonna show you guys later, I think. They still might be around my plums that are in full bloom, but everything's getting pollinated. Everything's gonna have great fruit set. It's just that we have this potential for frost, and it seems like it inevitably happens for a lot of you guys, especially further north of me. I seem to be in a nice microclimate because I'm so close to the Delaware, that water really brings in some nice protection from the frost. And we don't normally dip below 32 for the entire length of April. So if we can get into April 1st and even April 15th, I would feel very confident that we're actually going to have a full crop of these different fruits that I'm about to show you guys. And as an example, here are my beautiful, beautiful peaches. And I really should go around today, start taking some photos, because everything looks gorgeous. And if I wait, even yesterday, they looked way better than they do today. But if a real windy day comes in, it's gonna really destroy the appearance of a lot of these flowers. And they look much beautiful. Realistically, they looked way better yesterday. So I should take some photos. You know, this is the great time to do that. For that kind of thing, if you guys want to show off your garden. We pruned, if you guys remember, these espalier peaches, we took off so much growth. Here's actually the length of branches, some of them, that we took off, that three-year-old wood. And we made some huge cuts up here. You can see that, huge cuts. And it took out a lot of that top growth. Look at this cut up here. That's crazy, isn't it? That's like probably 2 inches in diameter, if I had to guess. So look at how much fruit we have, even considering all that pruning that we did. And what's gonna now happen is that these branches are gonna grow upwards and form that new systems of branches that we have down here. These are pretty much permanent on the second tier and the lower tier. These will stay here for a longer period of time, but I can recycle the wood up here at the top tier, and then therefore make these trees smaller in size, more manageable, and also still get some fruit. Like this branch here is coming off the top tier. I would imagine though, because some of these branches now, they don't have a whole lot of fruit up here at the top. So that means that there's gonna be a number of these branches that eventually take over and start now forming big systems of branches at the top of this tree. And you'll see that some of this is gonna bend over because of the fruit set, and it's not gonna get all that big. But some of this other stuff will take over and replenish that wood, recycle that wood that we talked a lot about. We also have, if you look here at our garlic, I didn't show you guys this in the other video, the first tour. There is just an incredible thickness and vigor and health of these garlic plants this year. I think these are way ahead of schedule, way ahead of last year. It's incredible. Even the shallots look pretty good. You can see those have all started to leaf out. We did mention in the other video these new beds that we've created. the mesh is extremely great at warming up the soil. And what I'll just want to show you guys is all these onions that we planted in here, and you can probably make them out. I have multi-sown onions in here, the Charles Dowding way, and it's worked out really great for me last year. If you want to know how I grow onions, check out our video from last year on multi-sowing onions. Charles Dowding does it best. So you really want to know the technique, I would try and watch one of his videos as well. Now, what else is going on back here in this section of the yard? We finally got to this area, and again, things are in bloom. Particularly, we talked about this maybe in a prior episode. What is blooming? We have honeyberries that are putting out flowers, as they're one of the earliest things to bloom. We have pears blooming. I would say probably in this order, ready? We have, at first, we have our apricots, we have our plums, we have our peaches. Then we start to get things like our honeyberries somewhere in there, probably maybe even before the peaches. Then we get, I think after that was our pears, then our apples. And what we also have things now forming, our cherries. I forgot about our cherries, are probably after the, believe it or not, they seem to actually be after this year, after some of these apples, or maybe alongside the apples. What we also have now is the gumi, and you can really make this out well today. I've been waiting for this moment. This is one of my favorite fruits now, guys. You can really, really tell is that they're like these silver areas here that look like the beginning of flowers. That's exactly what they are. They're coming out of basically every bud, which is incredible in my mind, because I would have thought that maybe there would be some specific rules to this, and that maybe they'd only come out of the tips, or maybe they come out of a certain age of growth. I don't know, but it seems like across the board, maybe not on this one-year-old shoot that came up, across the board, it's flowering just about everywhere. Maybe it isn't on the one-year-old growth. I haven't figured it out exactly the fruiting habit of this particular species of bush, but it's so good. This is one of my favorite fruits now. I'm so excited. And they also flower very early, so we should be expecting fruits off of this gumi plant by about June 1st. The honeyberries probably sometime around that, June 1st. Maybe June 15th for the gumi at the latest, but I wouldn't expect that. Also, the strawberries are gonna come in around that time. You can see I've transplanted some of these honeyberries in different locations. The one that I'm really excited for is actually this guy down here, because this is the boreal beast, and I also have another boreal berry, a honeyberry of that series. They're supposed to be very sweet, guys. And that's my key here, I think, to the honeyberry, is getting them extremely sweet. If I can get the sweetness higher, I really legitimately think they're an incredible fruit that everyone should grow. And they're gonna be even better than something like blueberries. A lot of these berries are gonna get blown away by these honeyberries. The pawpaw, I still would love to see some fruits. They're 5 years old at this point, entering their sixth season. Their sixth season, guys. And look at the size of them. They're so small. Yep, they're finally growing though, which is good. So this to me tells me I'm probably a year away. If not this year, I'll get some fruit. I'm not seeing any of these buds. People were telling me that there's a certain type of bud that you should look for, because that will tell you where the flowers are gonna form. I'm not seeing that. So maybe I'll have to wait next year. Maybe they're gonna be around the trunk of the tree. I don't know, I doubt it. We are also propagating more of the gumi, and all I have done is just stick a cutting in the ground, as I've done with other fruiting bushes and other plants. A lot of them, guys, propagate very easily. I'm not kidding. Like, here is some cuttings we got from Lance in Florida. I don't remember what this is exactly. It's either I think it might be a Jostaberry, or it's some kind of currant. I forget. But the point is that we just stuck these in the ground and we were able to propagate them. So which it's exactly why I'm pretty excited about the potential for more gumi plants. I don't know if it's gonna work out with the gumi, but we also have here the actual Jostaberry that I bought from the store, or I should say I bought from a nursery. And this one I'm really excited for because I like currants, I like the gooseberry, and the Jostaberry is that cross between the gooseberry and the currant. And I'm actually expecting pretty good production off of the gooseberries this year, definitely off the currants again this year. They're always so productive. So I would imagine these Jostaberries are probably gonna produce something for me. I'll get a taste of that, but I'm not seeing any flowers just yet. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, this is about when you would really start to see the beginnings of flowers. I can go and look at my other currants and see how they're behaving right now, because I think they're more similar to the currant. That's debatable, guys. I'm not entirely sure. I don't remember how this works, believe it or not. The fruiting habit of the fruiting habit of the gooseberry and the currant is escaping me. But for sure, I would expect maybe something out of this. Still very young. Now, what's in this box? Everybody is probably wondering, what the hell's in this box? I just got this from Ison's. And Ison's actually has sent me some elderberries. I ordered them. They didn't send it to me. I ordered some elderberry plants, American, and also a quince tree. We talked about quince in a recent episode of Fruit Talk. Check it out. Quince is a wonderful, wonderful fruit. Gonna make some amazing preserves. Also, the elderberry makes some of the best fritters, I heard. I have heard a lot about elderberry. It's probably and supposed to be the tastiest flower there is. So I'm excited just to try some more interesting flowers. Supposed to be better than the nasturtium, which I thought was the best. So I'm interested, especially for the flowers, not necessarily for the fruits, but the fruits are, you know, an added benefit. You can make wine and preserves out of them. We'll see how they go. I'd also want to try an aronia berry here, but I just am out of space. I think over here we're gonna put the elderberries over here because they don't need a whole lot of light. I do have over here these are Juneberries. These are Saskatoons that a friend of mine sent me, and I think I may end up moving these. I don't know, because this whole area, you'll see, ends up turning into these hostas, and they end up covering this whole space. But eventually they're going to outgrow that and they're going to be bigger than the hostas. So I figured I don't have to worry about that. But it would be nice, I think, for the future production of them, probably not to have them in this location. It just seems like it's too shady back in this corner. However, there is definitely some benefit of putting them here because they don't need a whole lot of shade, or they don't need a whole lot of sun. I am in a very, I mean, look how much stuff I got back here, guys. All this stuff is gonna turn into really big trees, really big plants. My kiwi vine here, the male, I don't know what happened. Somebody must have chopped this or stepped on it, because this was actually trained up this tree and I had it looking real good. So this tells me that my kiwi production is quite far away. Quite unfortunate. It's a little upsetting, but it is what it is. The plums are looking great. Espaillade now, they're looking beautiful. I have all these flowers down here, guys. I think bulbs are wonderful. They're really pretty. Underestimated, I think, by a lot of guys. We don't really put a whole lot of value in flowers, but it really adds a ton of beauty early in the season to your yard. Now, the apple trees here are flowering as well, and there's a lot of spurs I'm seeing. I'm seeing a ton of spurs activating and actually could turn into a pretty darn good crop here. And I'm really surprised by that, because I don't think these trees, these dwarf trees, are all that strong, but apparently, they must have dug in pretty well last year. They must have done pretty decently. And now they're gonna hold on to some fruit, I would imagine. We'll see what the actual fruit set is, but this comfrey under here, I really do believe makes these trees more healthy and more productive. Just having comfrey even growing nearby, I think is a huge benefit. Of course, there's chop and drop, but that's my goal with these apples. Some of them are a bit ahead of everyone else, which is really strange why certain apples are way ahead of schedule than others. This one would not be a great candidate for somebody in this climate. Zestar, because it's so early, it seems like, to bud, that I don't really recommend it. I guess the early varieties also flower early, right? I don't know. Does that make sense? Sounds right to me. The European grapes, we pruned them out. We talked about a video on those. You can see, look how vigorous and healthy this honeyberry looks. Oh my God. This thing's already almost fully bloomed or fully leafed out. Not a whole lot of blooms though. I'm not seeing a whole lot of flowers, which is pretty darn disappointing. Because at some point these things have to become productive, right? As they keep saying that they are. The last thing I want to leave with you guys is actually the muscadine grapes. And they say that you can't grow muscadines here, it's too cold. I found two varieties, Lane and Triumph, that do survive here. And I would expect some fruit. They can apparently survive negative 10 degrees Fahrenheit. Even though this winter was so mild, we only saw 14 degrees, I would expect these guys to survive. I don't have the hard data on that, but you can see them leafing out now. And I'm excited to try some of my very first legit muscadine grapes. They really do have a different flavor. And I recommend that you guys try them, grow them. And thank you guys here for watching this one. I'm gonna show you guys part three. It's gonna be a little quicker, I think, than this, because there's a lot of figs. Don't really have to pay too much attention to that. We'll see you guys for part three. Thank you guys for watching. Check us out on Fig Boss, Facebook, and Instagram. We'll see everybody soon. Take care, guys.